first to hit the lot and wave to the man in blue, yeah. Hello, 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 everyone. Welcome to this wonderful video where we have fun. Actually, we have some fun as we look at together the most intense viewpoints that really you're going to find here in this world. My job is to say what others will not say, and I'm able to do it. Now, a couple of things to start out with. For those who don't know, let me introduce the speaker. I'm sort of what you call a spiritual advisor. I have some credentials, feeble credentials, but it's better than nothing. Dharma Prince is a title given to me by Longchenpa. Longchenpa is the Dharma King whose court I'm functioning in right now. And I'm paired up with one of his very top assistants, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. And my job is to simply, I say what needs to be said. And, this isn't easy. I can do it, but not many can do it, and not many can stand it. I mean, how many are non-dual, this, right? Well, this video is specifically for those non-dualists. Okay, so Space of Allowance also decided to take an intensive. So Space of Allowance, this is your intensive, another intensive number two, you might say. It's time to get a boost. It's time for you to get a boost. And I felt today the information came. I've been considering your situation, and the insight came. Wow, very, very, very intense. Truth came today, and I'm still in the wow phase of allowing it to come in. But so we're not going to overload here, but we're not going to underload either. This is the secret. There's a secret to what Buddha said in Middle Path, and people keep obfuscating it. No, it means to don't underload yourself and don't overload yourself. Tortoise and the hare. Just keep this in mind. Tortoise and the hare. Don't go either way too much, because if you go either way too much, the wheels start coming off. You start going in a gully, ravine. Next thing you know, you're turning over, and you start panicking, and then you become like the lemmings who are all going off the cliff. I mean, culture's going off a cliff in the world. The whole world culture is going over a cliff, and they all say, well, we're all going over, so it must be normal, must be fine, no problem. So we pray to all the Dharma Kings to use their full array of action and capability and attractiveness to attract us away from that edge of the cliff that we're being stampeded towards, actually. So Space of Allowance, welcome to the video. We are going to look at something here, and we will ease into it. We don't want to rush into something so profound too quickly, all right? So just buckle your seatbelt. And everybody else, put on your seatbelts. Because you know I will say something which you're not, you say, you can't say that. What are you saying? But it that's what it's all about, actually. Now, to illustrate this tortoise and the hare situation and the situation we're in now, I had this amazing experience today. It perfectly illustrated it. So, I've been doing these intense workouts. On Saturday, I did skipping for like half a mile right out in public. It was intense. The next day, my legs, ankle, oh my gosh, you got sore where you can't believe you're sore. I said, wow. And then I think I took kind of a day off Sunday. And then Monday, I was back at it. And I just absolutely hammered the leg workout. Just intense. I just say, whoa. I'm not going to be able to walk tomorrow. Well, I was able to walk today, okay, and I said, oh, that's pretty good. And then today I said, surely Holy Spirit, day off today, and the Holy Spirit indicated I asked for a sign, it gave me exactly the sign I asked for. No, you got to do it today too. I said, you're the boss. So I went and I was working out the legs again. And I finally did doubles. This is amazing. I saw these guys who were running doubles. And I saw them running up and down, up and down, up and down. I said, holy cow, there's like, these guys are just going back and forth, running doubles. That is insane. And it's 100-degree heat. In the heat of the afternoon, 100-degree heat. I said, that is just, wow. These guys are something else. Young guys. And then something in me, the Holy Spirit said, why don't you try running doubles? I said, no, Holy Spirit, I'm not ready for that. I think it's about a month off. I said, I got to go not too fast. I won't overdo it. So maybe, I said, maybe at the end of the month, I'll be able to finally run a double sets, doubles, I call it. And the Holy Spirit said, well, give it a try. I said, well, maybe I don't know. So I tried. I said, well, that wasn't too bad. I did some more. That's not too bad. And long story short, I made it. Top of the mark. And those are these young guys were up there. And one guy was just crouched over, and he just looked like he was just like dying. They both looked like, whoa. I mean, I just like, I said, guys, how many times? How many sets you been doing? They said three. I said, whoa, that's very intense, man. That's just, yeah, it's hitting it really, really hard. And they and then one of the guys said, yeah, but I want to do five. We're doing five. Or actually, there was a guy crouched down, and he was suffering, and I was talking to him actually. And he said, yeah, my friend, he wanted me to do five. And he says, I haven't been working out for a couple months, he says. And he brings me out here to get me going. He says, but I'm just, five is just killing me. And then I spoke up. I said, hey, it's 100-degree heat. You guys are look like this is just killing you. I said, go eat, be sensible, be sensible here. So I was trying to tell him, look, three is enough for you. You haven't worked out for a while. He's overweight, and his friend's in great shape, obviously. And his friend is egging him on. Hey, you gotta do five. And then his friend said, "Well, we have goals. We got goals to reach." I told him, "Hey, be careful." And he goes, "No, we have goals to reach." Like he's kind of bragging about it. He's like a yoga guy. There's yoga girls and there's yoga guys. The key to it is they don't know. They don't have balance within them. They don't know how to do when to do the tortoise and when to do the hare, and to alternate them in an artful manner. So, this is what is key. If you want to be a spiritual coach, a spiritual advisor, such, you have to know. It's an art form. You have to be in touch with yourself and the overall grace of God to know when to accelerate and when to coast. It's the whole key to the path, and the ultimate key to the path is practice every day. So I left him there, but I was concerned about this guy because the heat is just scorching today, and this is out in the heat, and this guy, is he gonna drop dead? I hope not. But tomorrow, how's he gonna feel? He's gonna if he ran five sets, he's going to just gonna be wiped out. He's gonna be wiped out for a week or more. And you know what? He may not want to go back exercising for another 2 months or even longer. It's gonna put him off. Okay, so he made the mistake of taking a 2 month break from working out, and then trying to get back in shape too fast, like to sort of prove like, nah, the break doesn't bother me at all. I can take a break, 2 months break, at any time I want to. So see, so you try to. This is what happens when you're lazy. You then try to prove, oh, laziness doesn't bother me, because what you were really saying is, I can take a break whenever I want to, because look how great I can come back. Well, he wasn't coming back great. And he was exposed. I guess his friend was exposing him as being lazy for 2 months. So it's a very intense situation. His friend was arguing with him, and they were going back and forth. I think his friend said, well, maybe we'll do four or something. Maybe they're going to compromise. So very interesting dynamic that happened there. And leaving that situation, I realized this is the spiritual path. Is the key to it all is everyday practice. Because then you don't have to overdo it to prove that, oh, well, I can take time off, that doesn't bother me. because there's nothing to prove. You say, I'm not taking any time off, so I don't have to prove a point at all. And you're not underdoing it by taking time off either. I mean, you're certainly getting with it every day, so you're right. You're safe from both extremes. You're safe from both extremes. When you practice every day, that gives you this wonderful comfort zone of, I can do a lot today, but I don't have to try to do too much to prove a point. I don't have to do too much. On the other hand, I am working, I am giving an effort today, so I might as well put in a good workout instead of just doing a little bit also. So, ultimately, those who practice every day are on the road to success. And those who don't are not on the road to success, actually. Because it gets too ragged. Like this guy, he's going to be really hurting tomorrow. Severely probably dehydrated. Just the system's overstressed. And I know what that's like. I've been there. And that's when you start taking excessive breaks and you lose your momentum and all of that. And when you try to come back again, you might try to come back too hard, too much, and overdo it again. And there's a vicious cycle that starts. So the way to break this vicious cycle is very simple, is just practice every day. Stay engaged every day. Stay engaged with the path every day. I get up in the morning, the first thing I look at, Ram Maharshi slideshows playing on my computer. I spend some time with that. The next thing I do, I go to my Facebook newsfeed, and I have all these wonderful pages of wonderfully dedicated people who are constantly putting up pictures and quotes from the Dharma Kings. Ram Maharshi, Sri Sri Nandamayi Ma, are two of the ones that are really, really being promoted properly. And I see their pictures, I see their quotes. Oh, Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj also. So there's three different Facebook pages which are doing a great, great job. And then I just go through the newsfeed and just boom, 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 boom. And I'm just like, wow, wow. Now, I started out the day pretty doggone depressed. I said, wow, I think today's going to be a bad day. So I'm outside, and I'm just feeling like I think today is the day that I may start slipping. And then suddenly, around the corner, trots, pitty-pat, pitty-pats, 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 this cat, this wonderful cat, lovely cat. The cat just loves me. It's not our cat, it's a neighbor's cat. And it saw me, and it just looked like, oh, man, am I so glad. I just love to see you this morning. This just makes my day. And the cat just comes up to me, and I pet the cat. He arches back. Just, oh, I'm just, it's like, wow. It just appeared. This cat just appeared and just gave me all this love. Like I just think you're terrific. You know, I just really, really like, this cat just really likes me for some reason. I don't know why, but it just really does. And I just got this huge boost like that. See, cats are not slaves like dogs. Dogs are slaves. But cats are independent. So when a cat just on its own accord, just free as a bird, you know, the cat's just free to go do anything, go anywhere. When it just suddenly decides to show up to you and come right up to you and give you, you know, there's a reason for that. There's a reason for that. They did that for, that cat was guided for a reason to do that. And it means something, because again, cats are not slaves, whereas dogs are very much slaves. That's why people like them. Is the slave mentality loves dogs, loves to have dogs around. Not everybody has a dog, has a slave mentality, but I'm saying that it can lead one in that direction. It really, really can. I prefer cats because I love their independence. And they just say, hey, you know, I've got my own life. I'm managing it just great. Thank you very much. If I need your help, I'll let you know. And, you know, but they still give you the love. And when they do, you know, you feel like, hey, this is really cool. But they don't overdo it or anything. And then they're gone. You don't have to think about them or worry about them. They say, don't worry, I got this. You know, no problem. So I appreciate that. So that's how the day started, with getting boosts on the Facebook feed. It was great, great boosts from Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And then the cat gave me a boost, and so it started getting me going. It was a rough start, and you can have those rough starts. I didn't get enough sleep. You know, I wanted more sleep. It's a lot of stuff. I just felt exhausted, really exhausted. I said, how am I going to get through the day? Well, it's going great. The day's going great. It was very disjointed. I made the most of it. I mean, great things happened. And I started to get more and more positive, and then the insights started flowing. Rocking my world, absolutely rocking my world. And right now, I don't even remember what the insights are. This is how wowish they are. Well, I know what one of them was, is I saw the whole situation as from the angle of hope and seeing that all hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. Five little words. And I have this 55 on here right today, which is, of course, Tim Lincecum's number. And he's pitching tonight. But what it really means is this five words mantra I got today. All hope is false hope. Do that. And I was doing that. All hope is false hope. Do your fingers. It's a mnemonic device. We need to use these little mnemonic devices. All hope is false hope. All hope is dead hope. And that's the other five. All hope is dead hope. All hope is false hope. So 55, 5 and 5, 55. Five little words is all you need. If you can understand this, all hope is false hope. Meditate on that. Hear it and don't analyze it. Just wow it. Just wow it. Now the key to non-dual listening is what is said at first seems like terrible. Like all hope is false hope. Oh, it's horrible. I got no hope then. But you trust it. You trust the speaker. You should be listening to someone that you can trust. Trust yourself and trust in reason. Because we're so good at sabotaging reason that we almost never give opportunity for reason to speak to us. The success on the path is because we give opportunity for reason to speak up. We don't sabotage it. But you have to be very, very careful not to sabotage it. And you just... The first shock, all hope is false hope. Oh, okay, trust it. And you might be shaking from that. Just say, wow, it's very disturbing. All hope is false hope. And at first it seems terrible, but when reason starts to speak with you and present to you, suddenly it will shift and you'll suddenly see that's the best news you've ever heard. That's fantastic. Because what need does reality have for hope? Does truth need hope? Does God need hope? Does intrinsic spaciousness need hope? Does reality need hope? Consider this. Consider this. Does reality need hope? So then what is hope, actually? Hope is actually an attack on reality. Very clever attack. We think that hope is a corrosive agent, a decaying agent that can decay reality. And so what we try to do is we try to generate hope. And this entire scenario of bodies and world, time, space, process, and form, dream, is really an attempt to generate hope. And the purpose of hope is to somehow decay reality. That reality needs hope. Imagine that. Reality needs hope. Why? Now, hope, how do we generate hope? We generate hope through threat. Through threat. So, I hope I don't die today. Well, how could you have hope unless there's some threat to your well-being? Don't we hope for well-being? Well, if our well-being was perfect and internal and nothing could touch it, why would we need any hope at all? Consider this well. Why could we possibly need hope? Longchenpa says, the true realization is beyond hope and fear. Beyond hope and fear. And hope and fear are two sides of the same coin. Because hope only arises when we generate something that can appear to be threatened. But it's only the appearance of threat. Everything in this world is actually just an appearance. This appearancing is to generate hope. And we hope that hope can eventually decay, and change reality. Because our purpose of all this is to change reality. Why? Well, it's a whimsical, silly notion, but we're trying to be greater than God. We're saying, God, yeah, you created reality, but guess what? We can change the reality you created. So we try to do it through what's called hope. All hope is dead hope, because hope is based on death, actually. Hope is actually based on death. Death is something we're simply using to generate hope. I hope I don't die today. Every moment of our day, in the back of our mind, aren't we saying, you know, I hope I don't die today. I hope I don't get in an accident today. I hope misfortune doesn't strike me today. We live in a sea of hope, don't we? It's so normal to all of us, we never even think about it. But the fact is, we are always hoping. The attitude, the feeling we have is actually one of hope. And hope is actually fear. It's fear-based, entirely fear-based. What does reality have to fear? And what does reality need to hope for? And if there's nothing to fear at all, why would we need to hope at all? Why would we need hope? So hope is actually based on fear. It's based on threat entirely. All hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. It's all false, isn't it? We don't need hope. Eternal life doesn't need any hope. Eternal life doesn't say, well, I hope I stay eternal. No, nothing like that. There's no such thing as hope. And so you hear these non-dual gurus say, it's beyond hope and fear. You must go beyond all hope and fear. They're absolutely right. They're absolutely right. So we need to hear this and wow it and just say, wow, let reason start explicating it to us, which is what I did today. I said, okay, that's quite something. Let me listen to reason. And what does reason have to say about this? So you get past the reaction of, ah, it's terrible. Most people just say, what? Like, whoa, yeah, whoa. What do you mean? Hope's bad. Wow, we all need hope. But here I'm saying all hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. It's really the crux of our arrogance and delusion is to think, is we keep claiming, no, God needs hope. Hope's a great thing. No, it's our attempt to produce a corrosive agent, a decaying agent, which corrodes and tarnishes and decays reality. And hope is that what we're trying to use. We hope that hope will work. And we're all waiting in our little tree fort, you know, the girls and boys club tree fort, waiting for hope to succeed. We hope that hope succeeds in this. And of course, there's no possibility of succeeding in the slightest bit. But we're afraid to drop hope. We say, well, without any hope, we'd be miserable. No, without any hope, we'd recognize we don't need hope. That hope was actually an attempt to attack ourselves. Hope was an attempt to attack ourselves. So if we keep practicing, suddenly we can run doubles or skip. We can suddenly double up, in other words, double up on our effort, and we can do twice as much. Just, it was amazing. I was shocked. I said, I didn't know I could do that. I thought it would crush me. It didn't crush me at all. So how did I get there so fast? By not overdoing it. If I had overdone it and tried it prematurely, it would have set me back severely. Instead, I did as much as I could without, you know, I knew when to back off. I said, okay, like that. However, it, you know, sometimes backing off for a day can work, but I suggest every day you have to stay engaged. So there's different ways of staying engaged. Like for exercising, one day's your legs, next day's your upper body, next day's your cardio, maybe in some way, the flexibility. You know, you can do different workouts every day. So on this spiritual path, we can vary our workouts, but you have to be very keen about coming up with something new, because sometimes we get bored and tired of the same old workout. And you have to keep varying it every day somehow. The Holy Spirit will help you keep engaged. And then one day, suddenly, you'll be able to look at something and you won't freak out. You say, all hope is false hope. The entire problem is one of hope. We're actually trying to generate hope. That's what we've been doing here with this nonsense, with death. Death is just an attempt to generate hope. Without death, why would we need to hope for anything? We'd say, what do you mean, eternal life? There's hope, hoping for what? So only by introducing death and bodies and death can we generate any sort of hope. Because normally spirit, there's no such thing as hope. It's the most ridiculous thing you could ever imagine. It's completely ludicrous. Hope, what do you mean hope? For what? There's nothing is threatened. My well-being is not threatened. My abundance isn't threatened. Nothing's threatened. So what do I need to hope for? That's completely ridiculous. Is not hope the other side of fear? Of course it is. Hope and fear absolutely go together. So we're able to then suddenly entertain an insight such as this. And we realize we're going twice as fast. And we're getting pretty strong. Now, running doubles is what athletes do. And a spiritual athlete can, quote unquote, run doubles spiritually, which is see these double binds. The trap we're in are these double binds. And paradoxically, when we can see through the double bind, it loses its grip upon us. It's when we try to separate it out and defend it that then it becomes become panicky. So the key to the path is to simply let reason show you, oh, this is a double bind entirely. And just in going through this ordeal of seeing a double bind as it is, we start to get free of it. And then that's when later on, suddenly, you'll feel so much more confident and capable. And you'll feel like a spiritual athlete. We actually all have to be spiritual athletes. There's no way to succeed unless we're a spiritual athlete. You really have to be able to do these double binds and see through them. Have to. So we have to become really, really tip-top spiritual athletes, which means, you know, working at it every day, basically, right? Every day, just keep working at it. Keep working and working and working. And like this morning, you'll feel flat, as flat as a pancake this morning. It was just terrible. I said, wow, I'm so weak. I feel so terrible. This isn't working for me. And yet, I could run doubles because the overall strength was there. It was just the soreness and, you know, fatigue from work, doing so much workout that, you know, it was making me feel tired. But overall, the strength is getting better and better and better and better and better. And then more and more double binds are being seen spiritually. And you just see, if you don't do anything, just look at it and say, oh, wow, okay, I see that. Not a problem. It is hot. It really is hot here. Wow. It'll start cooling off a little bit here. But this is, you know, summer came in nice and strong. You like to see summer show up. And it has shown up. But not too bad. The Holy Spirit arranged things, so I went to a store today, and it said, gotta go there. Huh? What are you talking about? Is that a waste of time? And ended up not being a waste of time. I got an amazing deal on something I've been looking for a long time, and just haven't been able to get it. It's really weird. Put so much effort into get this, and suddenly there it is, at an amazing, just extraordinary discount. I mean, just wow. And then it was super discounted, then discounted again, and the clerk said, oh, there's actually been another discount applied to it. It's like triple discounted. Or actually, it's gone through before. It had another discount, but previously, it's like quadruple discount, and I got it for like, I see, a third of the price, or less than a third of the price, actually, of something really high quality, something really nice I've been wanting to get. A third of the price. Just like, wow, okay. And I got some shoes too that were super discounted, also a third of the price there too. Really expensive, nice shoes that I want to wear to. When presenting this, that ho all hope is false hope. This is just a shocker to everyone. There's no question about it. I mean, very few are ready to handle this, let alone present it. It's one thing to be able to hear it and let it sink in, and but it's another to just blast it out to the world and present it, because this is going to make you persona non grata. I mean, imagine me as a child coming to the world and saying, "Hey, everybody, all hope is false hope. All hope is dead hope. All hope is dead hope. All hope is dead hope. All hope is false hope. No, all hope is." They'd say, "You're the devil. You're terrible," and so they work to crush you if you're trying to, present that. But that's what I came to say. All hope is false hope. And this is really getting to, the extreme crux of the situation. Because this is the last place anyone would search for truth, is to say that all hope is false hope. The very last place, is it not? This is good. What is this? Mango coconut Provita. Mango coconut, really good. Wow, sparkling probiotic. It's tasty, it's sparkly, and you also feel like it's healthy for you. So I got some shoes to help with my presenting confidence. It's when you present something like all hope is false, so people are gonna look at you and say, "Are you okay? Are you okay? Are you okay? Wow, this, I mean, because they're thinking, wow, this person doesn't have any hope. They're without hope." And they're gonna like, well, so you gotta look like you're, a world beater pretty much, to say something like this, so people can say, okay, can trust it a little bit. Even then though, it's easy to have your confidence collapsed when you say something like this. Very easy. I don't recommend, people going around saying all hope is false hope, unless you're really highly, if you got to be, well, you got to be credentialed enough. And it's, I'm just saying it here in this video, but I don't go around telling people that too much to their faces, actually. They think you're attacking them. That's like the worst attack ever, right? Jesus says that here in the world, when you speak truth, people think you're attacking them. The ego says, "You're attacking me, you're attacking me." When you say all hope is false hope, I'm hoping the UPS truck will bring me something, but it didn't. There's some false hope right there. Waiting for my the freak is back. Yeah. The truth is back, it's like that. Lincecum is back in the big leagues. The truth, it's like the way he pitches, like the truth, like, here it comes, man. This is how you pitch. This is it. And they call him the freak. And now he's back in the big leagues. The freak is back. He's not pumping cheese anymore at 98. But when he was, man, oh man, it's the greatest show on earth. There was a while there, for 3 years, Tim Lincecum was the greatest show on earth. It was just unbelievable. It was just joyous. It was just funny, because it was like defying the laws of physics somehow or something. This little guy was just somehow catapulting the ball up there with like lightning, and it was just, the hitters were just shaking their heads and say, "This is just, this guy's just, it's just too much. I can't handle this." Nobody gave hitters more fits than Tim Lincecum. He just, they were overmatched. Then they knew it. They were absolutely overmatched. And he's just this little kid, like, looks like a skateboarder. They grabbed some skateboarder off the street, threw a uniform on him, and said, "Go get him, kid." And he says, "Oh, okay, dude, man, no problem." And he goes out there, and just says, "Hey, this is easy, you know. It's like the natural. You know, let me just chuck the ball up there. Oh, 98. How about change up? Do like this? Oh, okay, let me try this. Oh my God, you know. Hey, that works too, man. Cool, man." And then like you see him like skateboarding away from the park, you know, just sort of like along the sidewalk, you know. He's just like, "Oh yeah, man. Where's my backpack? It's all cool, man. It's all good. Just, you know, it's all natural." Just, it's just like, that was the impression. It's just like they grab someone off the street. Says, "We're desperate. Help us." He goes, "Oh, really? Want help? Oh, okay. Why not? Might as well help out." So people are like, feel that way. Like, it's like everyday man. It could just, you know, just amazing. It's just amazing. And then, you know, degenerative hip conditions that knocked him out of the game, and now he's got surgery and he's coming back, and you know, a lot of people are rooting for him, that is for sure. But the what he had, you know, he's probably not going to get that back, although we hope he does. But it's just that, you know, just the sheer wowness of Tim Lincecum, the sheer wowness that you have to have experienced that. Giant fans certainly did. Baseball fans in general. It's just, wow, this guy is like otherworldly. I mean, he's just rocking it out there and he's having fun. Wow. This little skateboard kid is just rocking it, and they can't handle this stuff. Too much good stuff. All hope is dead hope. All hope is dead hope. All hope is dead hope. So I'm just like this, you know, of whatever. It's, you know, out here in California, just saying this stuff and just rocking it, you know. And maybe the Tibetans are like, you know, say like, you know, wow, who is that guy? You know, what the world? And maybe some of the spiritual, you know, institutions and people they look like it just grabbed some guy off the street, you know, of California, something, some, you know, knucklehead out here. And lazy knucklehead, and says, "Hey, we need a little help, spiritual help. Could you help us out?" And, "Oh yeah, sure, why not?" And I'm like, wow, you know, really? All hope is false hope? Yeah, that's a nice change up you got there. All hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. All hope is dead hope. All hope is death, actually. All hope is death. Because that's what death is for, is to generate hope. So isn't hope death? Of course it is. Give up hope, you give up death, actually. You give up sickness, you give up all infirmities, you give up all threat. Give up hope, you give up all threat. The two go together. You give up one, it all goes together. It's one coin. It's one coin, it's one coin, it's one coin. Now, who trained Tim Lincecum? His dad. His dad was some aeronautics engineer or something, and he had some his own ideas of how to maximize the pitching motion, and so he, you know, nobody else trained him. And so he get this guy who doesn't seem to have any training at all from the institutions of baseball, coming on and just being an absolute world beater and just blowing everyone's mind. And they said, "Look, don't mess with his delivery. Don't say anything. Just let him do it." So the pitching coaches pretty much just had to leave him alone. But they didn't really like that. They said, "Wow, you know, we think we know how to do things right." And but they didn't know how to do it like he did it. And so the same thing with me is like I've just sort of been trained here by the Holy Spirit and the Dharma Kings in a certain way, not in any institution at all. And so I come out here and start chucking stuff like, you know, throwing a fastball like all hope is false hope. All hope is dead hope. You know, hope is death. Hope equals death. Okay, here's my changeup. Hope equals death. I'm throwing a Timmy Lincecum freak changeup right now. All hope is death. All hope is death. This is true. Hope equals death. Sorry. Hope equals death. All hope is death. Hope equals death. Hope equals death. Plain and simple. Hope equals death. Had a dream a couple nights ago where I was brought to death, the curtains of death. I saw that this is what death is. As you pass over to this other realm and you go through these like heavy drapes. So like mortuaries have these heavy drapes and everything. It's interesting that you sort of feel like this world's like a stage, and then you leave the stage, you go through these heavy drapes that kind of hide this stage from you, and then you're in this other realm. And I went to them and they were letting me through the drapes and saying, you know, okay, so you're ready to die, huh? Okay. Let us take you through death. I said, and then I went through the drapes and I'm looking the other side, kind of, but not so much. I was not that interested. I was just interested in going through the drapes and how that was. And then I told him, I said, no, actually, I'm just checking things out here. I'm just peeking here, and I'm not dying. And they said, what? What are you talking about? Nobody goes through the drapes like that unless they're dying. I said, well, I do. Meet nobody then. My name must be Nobody. And they were like very, very kind of like shocked by it all. You know, it's like, whoa, what's going on here? I was just checking death out. And so I say, okay, death. So hope is death. And let's say I'm not going to die means I'm going to drop hope. All death comes from hope, the attempt to generate hope. That's it. Without hope, if we drop, I don't need hope. Well, guess what? No more death. We don't need death either then. Death's just being used. It's just a ploy to try and generate hope. As if hope is some dynamic that can change reality. And again, when you're really pushing it right now, this is a time for the rat, the hare, you know, right now the hare needs to stand up. Traditionally, here's some way to put it. Here's an example. In this world, there's the tortoise and the hare. Generally speaking, the hare is the direct, fast, blunt, cut and dried clarity. Boom. All death, all hope equals death. That's the hare approach. Wow. The tortoise approach is to go about it much more circumspectly and slowly and say, what is death, you know, and what is hope, and do we hope for death, or does death give us hope? And yeah, you could look at it this way. You could look at it this way, or you might be able to look at it this way, and you just kind of really slowly kind of look here and there. This is the tortoise thing, or you sort of agree. Oh yeah, I really need hope, but then you say, but how much hope do I really need? And how does hope help with death? And is hope temporary because we all die, so hoping not to die is that false hope, you know, because it doesn't work? Or and you kind of you take this sort of slow approach. Now we say we use both approaches. One's assertions, one's flipping the script. The direct hammer approach is assertions. Hope equals death. Hope equals death. Hope equals death. Now, traditionally, we just use these labels and say this is the masculine approach, the male approach. Force, you know, power, force, determine, boom. Hope equals death. And the tortoise approach is to say, you know, what is hope? What is death? You know, can we hope not to die? Or do we have to die anyway? I mean, this is the tortoise approach, and traditionally, this is a feminine approach. This is the feminine approach. Indirect. Very indirect. Male approach is direct, female approach indirect. There's two different styles. And as you look at the world, you realize this is a truism, very much so. And what we want is to be a blend of both of those. So we got both gears, you know. I can be a little indirect, and then I can be direct, indirect, direct, and artfully shift, like driving a car, like driving a Ferrari, you know, and when to shift. This is what you have to do. You don't want to be with someone who's all indirect or someone who's all direct. You know, you have to be, the best is a combination, knowing how to shift. You want to be like that. You want to be able to shift between real directness and indirectness. Exemplifying indirectness is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. She was super circumspect and indirect. Also knowing how to be direct at the right moment. But she exemplified the feminine approach of indirectness. But the key to the feminine approach is nagging. And we know that women can be great naggers. It is very true. Because they're indirect, but they keep nagging you, and you're wondering, what the heck? You just said I don't really have to do this. if I don't want to, and yet you keep nagging me to do it. What's going on? If you want it, the men don't understand. If you want me to do something, just tell me and I'll do it. But the women won't do that. They say, no, I'm not asking to do anything right now. I'm not really, you don't have to do this for me. Then the next day he says, where's my such and such? I said, what do you mean? Oh, I really could use that. I said, but you told me I don't have to get it. No, you don't have to get it. I know it's true, but you know, yeah, I'm really, and then the next day he says, have you gotten my such and such yet? I said, well, you told me, you know, I don't need to get it. Oh, did I say that? You know, you don't need to get it? Well, you know, I really, you know, it'd probably be good if I get it at some point. I don't know, you don't have to get it now or anything like that. But, you see, and the next day they nag you again, and the next day they nag you until finally you say, well, I just got to stop this wasting my time. I just got to do this and get it done. This is the female approach. So this approach tends to work better when you're scared. And so not Sri Nanda, my mom would say, she'd ask, what do you think about this? And they say, well, this, and she goes, yeah, that's great. You know, some of them, whatever they say, she'd just agree with them. She'd always agree with whatever you said. She'd agree with it. And you'd say, okay, that's right. And then she'd say something like, you know, everybody's right from their own perspective. And so you're absolutely right from your own perspective there. And there's many ways to view the absolute, she says. In fact, there's infinite ways and infinite possibilities in all this. And then she said, but underneath them all is the great light. And so she'd always sort of slip in this absolute statement, always within this sort of vague context of, you know, it's all good, you know, don't worry too much. But then she'd nag you the next time. Every time she saw somebody, she'd remember everything. And then she'd say, so, like picking it right up where she left off, you know. So I remember that I talked to you about this last time, and yeah, how's your perspective now? Well, it's just the same. I said, oh, that's great. You know, being the same is really good. That's also an option you have. And then before you know it, then she'd slip in some other thing like, you know, like, hey, you know, I wonder if it's a good idea to try this, or it just occurred to me that to say this, you know, it's not like she's saying, look, this is the truth, you should do this. She goes, I don't know why, but it just occurred to me to say this, and, you know, so I'll just say it. But, you know, whatever God wants is perfectly fine. God's in control of everything, and there's nothing to worry about. This is the feminine approach. It's a feminine approach. It's an approach. It's a certain way of dealing with those who are really fearful and resistant, and they don't want to be pinned down at all to commitment or anything. And women know that they can get the ring on their finger through nagging, year after year after year. You do this, spend, you know, year. Finally, the guy says, oh, man, okay. All right, let's get married. This is their approach. This is the feminine approach. And then the masculine or masculine approach, you know, hope equals death. Is for those who, you know, who want a real strong workout, like, yeah, like, I just feel like I really want to accelerate right now. Who are not quite as fearful of acceleration. I mean, you give somebody a 750 horsepower car. I think that some of the Dodge Challenger, the Super B or something's got like 750 horsepower. You know, you might say, whoa, that's too many horses for me. You know, I mean, what if I hit the pedal too much? You know, and people are too scared. But if you could see, like, you know what, hey, if I want to hit the pedal, I'll hit the pedal. I want the horsepower there. You know, it's more like a muscle car mentality. I want the horsepower there, because if you want to get out of town in a hurry, you want the horsepower. So the male approach, I use both. I use both. It depends on how I feel and the situation. I use both approaches. But certainly, you don't want to overdo either one. Okay? And right now in the world, there's an extreme imbalance, which is why I say culture is going off the cliff. Because the male approach, the direct, cut and dry, black and white approach, has been demonized so much in this world. And the female approach has been lionized to such an extent, it's totally out of whack and out of balance in this world. And people simply cannot accelerate anymore. You tell them directly and they freak out, because you become too brittle. When you go too slow, when it's just one way like this, you end up becoming very brittle. And so you can't hardly admonish anybody or say anything. Someone admonished me, a woman admonished me in the parking lot. She said, you better repark. She almost hit that person. I looked, wow, that was pretty close. So yeah, I think I jumped out and I she saw me and she said that. And I said, yeah, I think I better repark. And I did, and there's no problem. I was thankful for her to speak up like that. But you try to be a man admonishing a woman now, you can't do it. Nobody admonishes women anymore because they're too brittle. Because it's an unbalanced approach. They're used, the ego suggested this very unbalanced approach. You, big surprise, the ego suggests an unbalanced approach, huh? First it says, no, we're just balancing things out. Too much male in the past. It very rarely is it too much male. I don't know any time in history where the culture just all advocated, you know, just a direct approach. I can't think of any time in history when it's really been like that. It's because almost nobody will do it. So there's always been, the tortoise approach has always been there very strongly. It's just a matter of trying to get enough direct approach to make the path work. You don't have enough direct approach, it's not going to work for you. So the struggle in this world is to more direct approach. That's what's always under siege in this world. Not the indirect approach, that's never under siege, hardly. I mean, when you knock out the balance, then it is under siege, actually. So the ego tricked us all and said, women, you need to, you know, more your approach is better. Well, why would the ego say that? Because right now what we need most is the direct approach. Because we got to get out of Dodge. I need a Dodge Dart pushmatic transmission to get out of town. Everyone I talk to, car guys, they all know the pushmatic Dodge Dart. And I mean, that car was awesome because it didn't look like anything. From the outside, it looked like just something your grandmother would drive. Seriously, really, but the car was so light and the engine so powerful, and the way the race car drivers produced that car. But they made it look like a dumpy thing your grandma'd be driving around Pasadena. You know, but that little old lady from Pasadena must been driving a Dodge Dart, pushmatic transmission on the dashboard. You push the shift gears, and so my friend had one, and he drove me all over heck, and he passed everything on the road. I mean, that guy was a passing maniac. He'd be driving on a two-lane highway, dangerous on a two-lane highway. He never stopped. He sees a car ahead of him, he just floors it. Just floored it. He go in the next the oncoming lane of traffic and just floor it. And he says, I can get around anybody in this car. And fortunately, he did. Otherwise, we would have died in a head-on crash. The Dodge Dart saved us. But if you want to get out of town fast, you need a Dodge Dart for Super Wedge, you know, 413. Okay, and a light car. That thing, there's times when you need to floor it and get out of town, which means back away from the cliff. Turn around and get the heck out of this cultural trap. So you need to be able to floor it and have a fast car and not be freaked out by it. And right now, anybody who says anything in a direct approach way freaks all the feminist culture out completely. Because they think they can do no wrong. The culturization since 1950s now, my whole life has been the woman is always right and the male is always wrong, plain and simple. And they call that balance. Pretty interesting definition of balance. You can't have that. It's basically saying one half of the equation is right and the other half is wrong. Now, we need both the tortoise and the hare. It's like saying the tortoise is all right and the hare is all wrong. That's not true. Right now, we need the hare to show up and put the pedal to the floor. Here's Dual Quad's drink. Now, the 413's lead is starting to shrink. He's hot with ram induction, but it's understood. I got a fuel-injected engine sitting under my hood. Shut it down. Shut it off, buddy. I shut you down. Yeah, I got out of town. Shut it off, shut it, buddy. I got out of town. Culture's going off a cliff right now. It's absolutely going off a cliff. And we're told, don't worry, baby, because the women falling off the cliff, they say, look how beautiful my hair looks. It's streaming up from my head as I'm plunging down this free falling off a cliff. They say, don't I look cute? Doesn't my hair look great? I love this hairstyle, huh? Let me do. I could do things with my hair as I'm falling. You know, it's streaming up high, and I, you know, put my hands up and cause the hair to billow out to the sides, and the men are falling too. And they're going, "Oh wow, yeah, you look so cute doing that. Isn't that great?" Meanwhile, you know, Wile E. Coyote is down there, you know, licking his chops at the bottom of the canyon. Wile E. Reptilian is down there licking their chops. And here we are thinking how cool the women look, you know, as they fall free fall through the air. And like everybody jumps off the cliff. How come you're not jumping off? That's too weird. Come on. Yeah. Great mix. Mango coconut. So we may not look like much, but we got a 413 under our hood. The super wedge. Or a maxi wedge or something they called it. Max wedge, max wedge, super wedge, max wedge, super mega wedge. The engine just cranked. That car just flew like a bat out of hell. And man, when you wanted to pass somebody, that's what you want. And so it doesn't matter if you don't look like much. Just say I'm a Dodge Dart. I'm a 413. But everybody seems to remember them. I mean, somebody told me today that he had a friend who put a 413 in this other car, a Chevelle, and hot rodded up. And said, "Man, that thing would go 150. Just absolutely crushed everything else. It was just a nondescript Chevelle, old Chevelle. But wow, you see a lot of muscle cars on the street now. That's the sign that we're saying, hey, you know what? We need the horsepower now." We need some horsepower. You can't do it all feminist way. You can't do it all the tortoise way. It's imbalanced. It's so out of balance. It's crazy. It's absolutely, that's why I say culture is going to take a hard fall, a really hard fall, a really hard fall. There's no directness taking place in the right way at all. There's just this tacit assumption throughout society now that men basically can't handle their business. Well, how about those who have a balance? No, only women can be balanced. Men are intrinsically out of balance. You know, this ideology is the ego basically telling us we can't succeed. There's no way to succeed. You got no chance. You got to go off the cliff. That's all that it's saying. You got no chance to succeed. But have a good time watching the women fall. Watch the different hairstyles they put on as they fall down the cliff, off, you know, free falling. And call it good. Call it good. But we don't call it good that way. We don't want anyone going off the cliff. Now. Here's the truth about the path and all of what we're talking about. Yes, the path is difficult. And in fact, you suffer more on the path than you would suffer normally in the world. Okay. So it actually is tougher. The truth is everybody is totally used to suffering. We're all suffering from hope and fear. All of us, constantly. It's hideous. Every single one of us is experiencing a very hideous trip, no matter how we try to spin it. Living in this morass, this matrix of hope and fear is horrible for everyone. But we're so used to it, we're so used to suffering, that to hear the good news that to hear the good news that we don't have to suffer at all. All hope is false hope. And when you give up hope, death goes with it. It's such great news that it just flattens us, just floors us. We just can't take it. You know, just we're so used to suffering and misery. And to hear the good news, we're not used to it at all. Who's used to hearing this kind of news? Nobody. So it causes stress. It causes suffering, a kind of suffering. As Sri Sri Anandamayi would say, God uses a thorn to remove a thorn. So a sticker that's stuck and you use another sticker to get it free. Well, the second sticker kind of hurts too. Hurts a lot, but it gets the first sticker out. So it doesn't stay in and start getting all infected, right? So yeah, I mean, once you get stuck, you don't want another sticker bothering you, but you have to do it to get that first one out. So the suffering that we're undergoing here, as we try to actually try to change reality, to prove we're greater than God through generating hope through death and threat. This is terrible suffering, and the spiritual path is because we're not used. So we're so used to suffering. The spiritual path might seem like it's even worse. You know, like wow, it's so difficult. But it's the difficulty that frees us from difficulty. It's the suffering that frees us from suffering. Whereas the other, the egoic path, doesn't free us from suffering or difficulty at all. It just perpetuates it. Just perpetuates it. He just says, yeah, if you just stay this way forever, we'll call it good. So you're waiting. So ego, what am I waiting for? Well, you're waiting for hope to change reality. Oh, gosh, I've been waiting so long. I'm tired of waiting. No, you got to wait a little longer. It's almost there. It's almost there. It's almost there. It's almost there. Stop waiting. Stop waiting for the upshot of hope and fear. Longchenpa. Stop waiting for the upshot of hope and fear. There is no upshot of it. It never shoots up like a rocket. Oh, wow. There's the blast off. Never. No upshot to it. Stop waiting for it. Wow, people are getting very pushy now. They're so out of balance that people are just thinking, you know, the women are so out of balance. The whole culture is that the women are getting nasty now, and they think that's the masculine. Okay. They've so propagandized themselves. They're thinking that just being vicious is, oh, that's the masculine way. Okay, so I'm balanced now. No, that is not the masculine way. That is not the direct way, cut and dry way. The cut and direct way is calm. It's humorous. It's clear. It's adamant. It's relaxed about it, though. There's no viciousness in it. They can't do the male thing well at all. They're not doing it well at all. Terrible. Most of them, you know, some of them can, you know, if it's really balanced out, any of us can balance it out. Any of us can. But that's few and far between right now. And men can balance out the slow approach beautifully, actually. The tortoise approach, but it's a matter artfully of blending the two, and anyone can be artfully blending the two. It's not gender specific at all, actually. I keep expecting the day to cool off, but it doesn't. So at some point, you might need to run doubles out of town. You know, really leap, 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 leap. Done. Do it twice as fast. At some point, you want that horsepower. You don't want all these governors on your engine. You know, these days, they put so many governors on your engine. They're basically driving the car for you, telling you what you can do and what you can't. Driving, well, that's not good. this activist. I saw these activists today, and they bought a house near some place they don't like, and they're protesting a business nearby. The business has been there for a long time. They chose to buy the house there, and then they're claiming that their children's not good for their children. So I say, well, if you have children, isn't it your responsibility to decide where you want to live? Is that the business's fault? You move next door to a sewer plant or something, and then you want the sewer plant shut down because the smell, it's not, the kids don't like the smell. What is that? They say, well, no, you're abusing my child to smell the sewer plant. No, you're abusing your child for moving there. That's, the parents are doing the child abuse, not the sewer plant. They don't see it that way at all. They think, gee, I should be able to, basically they're activists, and they say, okay, I'm going to move my, this is how the activists just use children, actually. They use their children. And conversely, the children may be the activists themselves using the parents. There's also parental abuse going on, maybe more of that than anything. We assume the child is innocent. Children aren't innocent at all. They come into this world with an agenda. Everybody comes in this world with an agenda already set. And so the child already has that agenda, and the children may want to be shut that sewer plant down, so they have their parents move there, and then claim, "Hey, mom, this is bothering me. You got to do something about it." And the mom says, "Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, people think I'm abusing my child by moving here, so I better shut it down." So it could be very well that the abuse is coming from the children; they're the ones fostering it. I know everybody comes in with an agenda. I did. Everybody does. So I still stop denying it. There's no such thing as children just come in blank slate. That doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. That's a, it's a fantasy. They have all the samskaras, all the habits, all the ego agenda, everything that they want to accomplish here as far as generating hope, etc. So yeah, I mean, it's amazing seeing that this stuff, how upside down and backwards everything is here. Nobody taking real responsibility. Everybody blaming somebody else. This is a culture's headed for, the culture's headed for a hard, hard fall. Hard fall. And it could be as early as within a month, actually, that we are headed off the cliff culturally. Absolutely headed off a cliff. So well, I got to stand up and say, what? All hope is false hope. When people are desperate for hope, that's a tough sell, isn't it? It's a very tough sell. Will anybody even listen to that? Well, the real non-dualist will. Those are desperate enough. They say, let me just wait until reason kicks in, see what reason has to say. And the greatest breakthroughs I ever had are when I first hear something that just seems completely contrary to normal belief. And I think, oh, that's terrible. What do you mean that? And then I let reason show me why it's so good. And then suddenly I see it through the eyes of reason, and then I say, oh my gosh, that's liberation, that's freedom, that's fabulous. Jesus says, don't do anything, do absolutely nothing. Don't pay any attention to the past, don't pay any attention to the future, drop all thoughts of the past, drop all thoughts of the future, don't do anything. He says, this is the key to opening the door. Door opens to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will tell you exactly how to, what's in harmony with its plan and its perspective. Don't do anything. Just sit here and do nothing. He said, at that moment, you're free of most of your thoughts, most of your thinking. This sounds like counterintuitive, but I stayed with it long enough to suddenly I saw what he's talking about. I said, oh my gosh, judge not lest you be judged. Don't judge anyone for anything because they're absolutely free. When you judge them, you seem to say that somehow the past determined where they are now, and somehow where the way they are now is going to determine their future. That's what's called judgment. And if you believe that they're judged in that way, so too will you believe you're judged in that way, and you will not experience your freedom. Judge not, lest ye are judged. Super profound statement by Jesus. That needs to be understood and is not talked about nearly enough. if we just do the tortoise, 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 we start lowering our sights to the point we think that anything doesn't fit in tortoise mode can't be true. That nothing can be black and white, cut and dried, obvious to us. It must be all be vague and wiggle room everywhere. No, that's too much tortoise. Too much tortoise. And I tell you, all cultures got way too much tortoise in it. Even the well-meaning folks, too much slowness. You got to be able to hit it fast when the necessity arises. So we've done our three sets here. I'm not going to push for five sets here. I could do it, but no. Three sets is enough. This bringing all this up here is a lot. The whole hope thing is extraordinary. I just everyone pray for me. I'm able to deliver this message more strongly, really, and try to be supportive of this, because you're very rarely going to see anyone in this world deliver this message. Very, very rarely, just super rare. And I'm only able to deliver it because the Dharma Kings have delivered it first and show me the way and supporting me and supportive of me to do this. I couldn't have ever done this. You think you're a complete pariah. I mean, the world will turn against you. You think they'll never turn back to you. You know, it's right? Scary. So let me keep delivering this message. And, you know, for some, the role is to be, you know, say, hey, I like the message. I love the message. This helps the message be delivered. It takes two to deliver a message, really, here in the world. If nobody is interested, it makes it very difficult to deliver a message. But if those who are interested in and in supportive of it, then it becomes a lot easier to deliver the message. And this message is so difficult to deliver. You know, it would be helpful for some supportiveness for this. You know, that said, yeah, bring it, love it. I want to hear more of this. That all hope is false hope. All hope is dead hope. Hope equals death. You know, this sounds like a very profound, important message that we need to keep hearing and keep hearing and start normalizing this message. Because, you know, obviously most people in the world would just run away. But what people want is they want hope, that hope will work. If they think the teachers are here to help generate more hope in them. This is exactly the opposite. The teachers are here to free us from all hope. This is what they're really for. Jesus said, I didn't come to save the world, I came to condemn it. Meaning, I didn't come to prop up your hope that hope will work. I came to tell you that hope will never work. That hope is actually what is bringing your death to you. You're just death experiencing and aging. Everything. All nastiness, all threat comes from hope, trying to generate hope. Most people want to be liked in this world. They're not going to say this stuff, because this is just going to cause people to hate you. And Jesus says, if you follow my gospel and proclaim my gospel, the world's going to hate you just like it hated me. But remember, it hated me first. So be of good faith and good cheer. And this is, you know, the crux. Jesus knows that the world, it lives on hope. And they think without hope, they'd have no life. But this is ludicrous. They'd have the life God has given us, which is no need for hope, because it's perfect. There's no threat to our life. So what do we need hope for? It's just that we set hope down because we don't need it. It's just a silly, whimsical, idiotic notion. someone challenges me or says, I would say, look, by what authority are you contraindicating what I'm saying? Show me your authority. Give me your authority. Otherwise, be quiet. Don't contradict what I'm saying unless you have authority behind it. By whose authority are you saying this? Let me talk to the one who told you that this is not true. I want to find out who that one is. Tell me. No one's been ever able to tell me here. They're just evasive. No. If there's authority greater than God, let's hear from it. I'd say my authority comes from God, Jesus Christ, and the Dharma Kings, the Holy Spirit. So that's my authority, and from my own from the reason within me, from my own clarity about it. So where is the authority to contradict and contravene this and say, no, this is, shut up, don't say anything, this is inaccurate. Where's the authority to tell me that shut up, it must mean what I'm saying is incorrect? Well, where's the authority that's saying is incorrect? I want to see that authority. Maybe I want to go directly talk directly with it. But everyone's all vague. Well, because there isn't any such authority. But they're assuming that there's authority. There's no authority contravening truth. There's no authority contravening truth at all. Love the heat. It's an excuse to drink these drinks, but I'm gaining weight. Drinking these sugary drinks, that's bad. It puts weight on severely. I'm getting like 4 pounds. I'm eating pasta, a lot of pasta for some reason. And the pasta puts on the weight too. But there's something about, I don't know, the heat makes you want to eat. Somehow. You want to feel like there's, because you're melting away. You want to feel there's something substantial there so it doesn't all melt away because it's so warm. But I don't know. I feel good. I was out in the heat and working out, and so far I feel pretty good. You can get used to it, actually. Someone came here from Mexico where it's super hot right now, and it was like a hot day here, and they said, it's so cold here. Why is it so cold here? I like it, she says, but it's so cool. And we said, what are you talking about? This is hot. He goes, no. This is cool. Where I come from, it's hot. It depends what you get used to. So I speak up the truth. Hope, all hope is false hope. And of course, when you're making saying that there's no exception to hope, you're hoping to realize that, of course. So of course, you cannot include the statement which points out that all hope is false hope. You cannot include your hope that you see this clearly. Otherwise, you fall into just absurdity. So Jesus says the illusion, the final illusion, dispels all other illusion. The thorn gets rid of the thorn. The hope that we realize the clarity that all hope is false hope. We hope that we realize this. But ultimately, in reality, there's no need for any hope at all. We don't, in reality, we don't say, well, I hope I realize that reality is true. No, it's it's none of that. But from now, we hope we realize that all hope is false hope. We hope we realize this. See, I have a nagging approach too. I keep returning, nag. That's the female approach. Just keep returning, re-emphasizing, look at it this way, keep doing. Finally, just like, wow, okay. That's, yeah. And then intersperse with the direct approach. All hope is false hope, period. Black and white. That's all we need to know. just realize this, see it, and that's it. The double bind, you know, double binds go. The ego keeps trying to trap us in double binds. I got these shoes that were too small for me, half a size too small. I have worn half a size smaller before. If they break in, they'll be okay. That's a different feel. It's a different feel. It feel kind of more like muscle car. You feel more muscle car-ish when your shoes are half size shorter, smaller. But I got wide, so that works okay. Because that's what it was on sale. Yeah, so our psyche, we're realizing, wow, we're way out of whack, way out of balance. Radical feminism is just crushed us, done a terrible job. And POTUS is just, of course, a front man for radical feminism, actually. That's all he is. He's a front man. He's a poker-faced front man. Lies with a poker face is all. And activists look for front people, usually front men, because a lot of times activists are women, actually. They want a front man who can just lie to everybody and smile with a smile, you know, like a used car salesman, the poker player, just smirking and smiling and lying and through their teeth, and can laugh about it, and people just kind of, good old Charlie, pat him on the back and say, yeah, he's a front man. The POTUS is just a front man for radical feminism. That's all he is. The radical feminists have been calling the shots in culture for quite some time. And that's why things are so out of whack, out of balance. I think people are saying, whoa, 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 whoa. We're going over a cliff right here now. We're going to go over a cliff. We don't pull back from this. And so the other side, symbolized by Trump, is saying, hey, you know, let's bring back more male perspective. He's very blunt and direct. And a lot of people really like that. Say, wow, we need more of that. Well, yeah, we're so out of whack now. But I don't think it's savable, actually. I think we're headed for a hard fall. We're so out of whack, and that causes us to become so brittle that, you know, nobody can say anything politically incorrect without everybody screaming, I'm breaking, I'm breaking, I'm breaking. No, you should say, I'm accelerating. I can't handle acceleration. I'm going to fall apart. Well, you know, then you better modify your car. You know, you don't want a car that falls apart when you start going, you know, 10 miles an hour. You know, they say, I got to go 5 miles an hour. It's too fast. 10 is too fast. Say, hey, we got to go fast now. So the whole thing about the ego of making us all so brittle is so we'd all fail. Because egos say, well, hey, you're falling apart when we need to go fast, which is right now. We all need to go really fast. The ego says, no, you're not fair to the women. They all fall apart. They're too brittle. Everybody's too brittle. Well, that's their problem. I mean, it's their fault for going along with the ego's scheme. With the ego's always scheming how to entrap us all and double down on arrogance as if, you know, to generate hope, keep waiting for hope to work. So now we have to go fast. And those whose cars fall apart, well, you know, they can't handle the speed, then they're going to have to slow down. They're not going to make it. It's that simple. Not this time around. And they hope that we feel so sorry for them that we'll slow down too. No, it doesn't work that way. That's an entrapment plan. It's absolute entrapment plan. What's going on in this world, this matrix, this computer simulation? It could very, you know, there's a lot of young people who say that this world is just, you know, the matrix, a computer simulation. Well, you know what? They're closer to the truth than the scientists are. The other people, you know, they're way closer to it. It could very, it, they use the term computer simulation because that's just a lingo in you know, labels. But it points to something. It's a simulation. It's a game. This could very well be true. Very well be true. It's very likely true. So they're in the ballpark with this. Okay, those who, the Matrix and all this, very much so. It's way closer to that than what the scientists say, who are really anti-scientists. You know, it's funny, the English are great scientists. I respect them for that, because I'm a scientist myself. Scientists allow the facts, they follow where the facts lead them. They have to be very courageous and intrepid. So that's what I've done with my life. I followed where the facts have led me to. All hope is false hope. That's where the facts led me. So this is what I'm proclaiming. I'm a scientist. These are my conclusions. This is what I said. This is where the facts have led. I followed the facts. But the problem with the British is they're such good scientists that they're also really good anti-scientists. When they don't like where the facts are leading them, they can also be very clever in having, in selecting only the facts that will support where they decide they want to be. So they don't follow the facts. They have the facts follow them. Anti-science has the facts follow them. So the British are very good in both ways. Very good scientists and very good anti-scientists. So, you know, it's a mixed bag. I'm telling it like it is. I mean, they're the ones that get some jokers who go out and fake a clumsy crop circle and then admit to it, hey, guess what? I faked it. And guess what? All the rest of them are fake too. And everybody buys into that nonsense, you know. Like, so if one person fakes something, then all their examples have to be fake. What is that? That's anti-science. It's anti-science. So they kind of like feel like they own science, and so they can also promulgate anti-science. And who better to know how to put forth anti-science than those who are experts in science? And so they do a lot of that, unfortunately. But they've also done a lot of great science. It's funny, it's a conflict there, isn't it? So you got to be very careful about this anti-science. Okay, the Western world's very good at anti-science. They're very good at science, very good at anti. And right now, anti-science is ruling the world. It's absolutely ruling the world. They say only the facts that support my, you know, arrogance are facts. Nothing else is a fact. That's called anti-science. So the world is being run by those who hate science, actually. Super prejudicial against science. Super bigoted and intolerant and prejudicial against true science. Horrible. We live in a dark ages, actually. When people talk about science as liberating us from the dark ages, well, guess what? We're back in the darkest age we've ever been in right now. Super anti-science perspective, and that's being promoted as if it were science, and it's not. It's worse than junk science. It's anti-science. And Trump comes along and says something. People are so brittle. They're just pointing out how brittle we all are. You know, just because someone said we don't have to fall apart. What is that? Someone says something direct, and we'll say, well, you know, okay, I heard what you said, and let's take a look at it. And, you know, maybe that would be helpful, maybe not. But thank you for saying it. I mean, it's an idea we can float and take a look at here, yeah. Where's the brittleness of that? Let's look at both sides of the situation, weigh it out. Instead, everybody goes into this phobic mode. I mean, it's like professional phobics right now. Anti-science, we're science phobic, truth phobic. You know, and that's all boils down, and you can just symbolize like Trump phobic. There's so many people Trump phobic. I was thinking, I'm gonna get a T-shirt that says Trump on it, and go to San Francisco, and I tell you, I would rather be Stanley and Livingston, going through, you know, the Congo on a canoe, and pulling into these little villages by the in the jungle, and they say, hey everybody, how you doing? They say, hey, welcome, and they say, what are you doing? Well, we're doing kind of this ritual here tonight, we're doing this thing here. So, well, what are you doing? Well, we're gonna like sacrifice these people, bash their heads in, and you know, and then feed them to the gods and stuff, and feed on them, you know, eat them. And they say, wow, really? And then they say, look at your flesh, you look like tender, juicy. Love it. You look wonderful. But why are they looking at me like they would like to eat me? You know, it's kind of a weird look. They have to be like, oh yeah, you're so beautiful. They're kind of like looking at a steak in the butcher's market. Oh, look at that beautiful steak. I just love to roast you. So Stanley Lewis was like, you know what? You know, I think I'm going to be trekking on down the road. Thanks anyway for all your, you know, adoration of me. But I kind of like the flesh on my bones for right now. But I tell you, you'd be safer in one of those little villages on the Congo back a couple hundred years ago, whenever. You're way safer there than I think if you wore a Trump shirt in San Francisco. I think they'd throw you in a vat of boiling oil, actually. Seriously. I don't think you'd get out of there alive. I think you have a better chance to get out alive out of a cannibal village than you would in San Francisco if you wore a Trump t-shirt. So, I mean, so that means they're more savage than cannibals, doesn't it? And you could say that. This is why I say we're in a dark age, a very brittle dark age, anti-science, anti-truth, anti-reason, anti-male, anti-hairness, you know, with the ability to, you know, muscle up and go fast. It's anti-proper balance, anti-so much. It's a dark age. We're living in the some of the darkest ages this world has ever seen. And yeah, I love San Francisco. I love the people. And I've always been supportive of the place. But you know, truth is true. I mean, if you wore a Trump shirt there, you probably wouldn't get out alive. Seriously, that's why nobody does it. Still, not a single Trump sign or bumper sticker in the Bay Area. Not one. I almost want to do it just to break the ice. I said, this is crazy, people. It's just showing you, it's just basically saying, I'm so freaking brittle and so Trump-phobic. I'm so phobic and anti-science that I can't handle it. I would implode. So I'm going to implode you instead. You know, this is how dark the Dark Ages are here. This is like the seat of the Dark Ages here in the Bay Area, actually. This is like the heart of the cave of darkness here. It really is. I don't have any problem supporting San Francisco, supporting this. I don't have any problem with supporting everybody and say, speak up. Let's get some tortoise here. We've got plenty of tortoise. Let's get some hair here. Let's get some male perspective on the problems we have. No. Only the female liberal perspective, the phobic perspective, anti-science phobic perspective. Sticking our head in the sands. Let's go slow, 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 slow. No, slow down too fast. Slow down too fast. Say, so wait a minute. At some point, you got to speed it up. Two. It takes two to make this work. And so, no, they can't handle it. You get too brittle. This is a problem. You get too much anti-science. I mean, technology is Stone Age junk. It's Stone Age junk. It's primitive. It's antique, actually. The technology that's coming in the world and it's smartphone, that's antiques. That's old junk. You should see that in some musty corner, some antique store. Like, what the heck? This stuff has been tried throughout the cosmos over and over and over and over. It's such an old story. It is so junky, so old-fashioned, so out of shape. It's like bell bottoms coming back. Are you kidding me? Bell bottoms and smartphones, man. I mean, wow, you can't, you got to be kidding me. You're not bringing back smartphones and digital technology to this world. Are you kidding me? That's such a failed notion. Only tree fort gals and guys would you know, the little tree fort say, we're going to change God. Fall for that old trick, of technology. What a joke it is. It's Stone Age stuff. So we're back in another Stone Age. I'm telling you the truth. We are in a spiritual Stone Age right now. If going off a cliff. And I don't see any way to stop it from my perspective. Hopefully we can attract many back away from the edge of that cliff. But I wouldn't be surprised, if the number is not, large. That's true. The harvest is many, but the laborers are few. I don't know. Seems like the harvest is not so strong. But we gotta try. We gotta try. Now, again, it's about balancing the tortoise and the hare, using both properly. And we're so absolutely freaked out by the male perspective, the direct perspective, because the ego hates it. Because the ego wants an imbalance, so the path doesn't work. And it's always easier to throw the blame onto the man. It's, oh yeah, the man, he's clumsy, he goes too fast, blah blah blah, it's dangerous, that kind of thing. Well, yeah, we're dangerous because we're afraid of being rewarded. The whole problem is, really, is that we've set this whole game up. Okay, now this is what I wanted to get to, and it's taken me a while to get to it, so hopefully you're hanging in there. We've set this like a computer simulation game up, and we said when we develop enough hope. No, here it is. When we realize, okay, this is what we told ourselves. When we realize this is all just a simulation, we win, and we win a great reward for that. Okay, this is what we told ourselves when we fabricated this game. It's really a mental projection that we all worked on. Jesus says we've all collaborated on this to an extreme extent, to an unbelievably extreme extent, he said, to try and produce this game which would deceive us all, and we would think it's real. just like I said, producing a universe that has this semblance of age. So we think, oh, this universe really has been around millions, billions of years. Like a computer game, they want to make it so realistic, and the avatar is so realistic, you think that you really are the avatar in the game, and you're in this, you know, land that time forgot. You really are in the land of the dinosaurs, and they really are bogs that have been there for, you know, hundreds of millions of years, and fossils everywhere, and you think it really, time really does exist. We have worked on this simulation of time and space and process and form for so long, so much effort. We wanted to see if we could fool ourselves, and if we thought we could fool ourselves, we could fool God. So, but what we told ourselves was, is that if we actually see through it and realize it's all fake, it's all just a mental projection, there's no real time at all, nothing's ever happened. If we see through it, they say, guess what, you won, and you get this fantastic reward from God. God will reward you fantastically. So we're thinking, oh, that's great. Wow, there's a reward. Okay, but here is the whole trick to the entire situation that we're in, and this is the big one, is that it's the reward that scares us, because we're already perfect. We're already perfectly awesome, and what we told ourselves is, if we graduate from this simulation and realize it's all just a fake simulation, we're going to get like the super awesomeness that God has devised all this to empower us with super awesomeness, more than perfect awesomeness, if we see it's all fake. We told ourselves that God has this secret super mode called ludicrous mode, like Tesla's got this thing, and you unlock it, it's ludicrous mode, where the car goes even faster, you know, super fast. So it's like this ludicrous mode that we told ourselves that God's creation has this hidden ludicrous mode. But the only way to activate it is to deceive ourselves with this simulation. And when we see that it is a simulation, that unlocks the ludicrous mode. And we go into the super awesomeness beyond perfect awesomeness, even great, you know, way greater. We told ourselves this. Now, there's not a shred of truth to any of that. But we're so scared about this super awesomeness mode, beyond the normal perfect awesomeness that we are, that we're terrified about discovering it's a simulation. So our continuity fear, a fear of this reward, is what literally causes us to continue to be blind and act like idiots, like we can't see through it all. We can't see intrinsic spaciousness. I mean, it's ridiculous, because we're afraid of this super reward that we think that's going to unlock some secret of the universe. God has put the secret in the universe that's going to make us, propel us to be even greater than God. You know, that's the snake in the Garden of Eden. So you'll be even greater, you'll be like God. But the idea is, yeah, if you find out, you'll be even greater than God. This is what terrorizes us, actually, and prevents us from seeing through the whole situation. However, when we see that none of this is true, we made it up entirely, we made the simulation up, we say that there's a secret mode, when you see through it, God will give you the super reward. We made that up too. There's no reward for seeing through it. And here's a non-dual, again, opportunity to let your reason speak. Don't react to this. I said there's no reward at all for seeing through that this is all just a fake simulation, a mental projection of our imagination. There's no reward. So what does that mean? Well, we just realize we don't need any of this. It's fake, and we see what is true now. But truth is its own reward, because we'll see that we're perfect. Why do we need something more than that? So the truth is, there's no reward for seeing through this delusion. None. We just default to what we already have always been, which is perfection, bliss. When we don't have hope, guess what? We have bliss. Hope is what keeps us from experiencing bliss. What does bliss need hope for? What does bliss need hope for? So the whole thing can be boiled down to these dynamics we talked about in this video. It is a dreadful fear of this reward. Well, guess what? The good news is that Jesus brought, there is no reward. So no more fear of awakening, is there? No more fear of recognizing through this delusion, this mirage. We say, oh yeah, I see it's a mirage, of course. There's no reward for that. But now I feel, I don't need any hope, and I feel bliss. I feel bliss. I feel perfection. I feel absolute freedom. I feel, you know, the way that God created me to feel, which is, you know, this perfect happiness. So I don't need anything more than that. I don't need the super awesomeness. So we lied about God. We said that there's this secret, you know, mode. We can unlock this secret mode, like a generator that prevents us from being even greater if we do this. And none of that's true. We made it all up. That's the lie. The snake lied. Our lie. Very sly lie. There's no reward. Okay, all hope is false hope, and there is no reward for enlightenment at all. No reward. Nothing is unlocked. And now when we see through this mirage, and we say, oh yeah, see intrinsic spaciousness, then we're abiding it, then we start thinking, what kind of reward am I going to get? Okay, when's it going to come? It hasn't come yet. And you start getting nervous. You say, I don't think I want a reward. I better go, it's safer to go back into delusion again. And so we go back into delusion. So this is the problem with abidance, is we're really afraid of the reward coming, and we think it's too much, because we already are completely full. We say, oh my gosh, if I get more, I can't handle it. There is no reward. Just tell yourself, there is no reward whatsoever. It doesn't exist. Practice that. There is no reward. Five syllables. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. Okay, these are super powerful practices. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. So you have two five-syllable mantras here. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. 55, number 55. Go get him, Timmy. I don't know how he's going to go get him. We'll see. I think he had too many jitters last time. He was trying too hard. That's what happens. If you try too hard, you're too amped up, you're trying to please too much, everything's off. You got too much adrenaline. You just got to settle down, relax, and don't try to please anybody. Just have fun. So, what are the two mantras we have? Space for allowance. What are the two mantras? Space of allowance. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. So just remember, 55. Where is it? Over here. 55. Number 55. Just remember Tim Lincecum as a little mnemonic device. The freak, Timmy Lincecum. All hope is false hope. Number 55. Now, 55, of course, is the year before I was born into this hopeful realm, hoping for a reward. And, of course, not realizing the very hope for a reward is what is causing us to remain attached to this nonsense of hope in the first place. What is reality to hope for a reward for? It's got everything. Hoping for a reward, how crazy is that? Got this beautiful background, don't we? A colorful background here. It's pretty amazing, the light show we're getting here right now. I'm enjoying the light show as I'm taping this. I'm seeing it, you know, on the monitor here. It's like, wow, this is really beautiful. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. Okay, the non-dualist practic can handle this because they just say, okay, I trust it. Let it sink in. Don't overthink it. Just let it, just wow it. Just wow it. Just wow it. Just wow it. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. Yeah, use your fingers for rosary beads. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. Like that. Okay. Thank God I got to that. I forgot it. I knew I'd forgotten something really important. But I said, I didn't struggle with it. I said, okay, if I need to stop now without it, that's fine. I didn't try to remember what it was. It's very key. When you try to remember something, you bury it even more. Don't try to remember it. Just keep going. And suddenly it popped into my mind. There is no reward. Wow, that was super important insight today. Just amazing insight. Holy cow, there is no reward. Thank God there's no reward. That's because we think that we'd have more than everything, and that would like freak us out completely. It's a freak out. How could you say more than everything? It's a complete mental freak out. So thank God there's no reward. There's no reward for realizing that truth is true. It's just that truth is true. That's all. It's not a reward. There's nothing added, you know, extra bonus. It's just we realize that trying to change truth is impossible. There's not that we don't say, oh, guess what? You're realizing that reality cannot be changed. You now get a higher reality. No, there's nothing like that. And thank God for that, there's nothing, no reward. Because realizing this is, again, the key to accepting reality as it is. Because if we think we're getting reward for seeing reality as it is, then we're not accepting reality as it is at all. We're claiming it's got to be changed, right? Saying we get more than everything is a change. So saying we get a reward is really saying, we guess what, when you see through that this is all a delusion, that changes reality. And God set this all up to change reality. So you've activated the change. Congratulations. Now, that's a way to scare ourselves. So this whole idea of reward is the deepest, deepest treachery we use to scare ourselves away from reality. So all thanks to those who are doing these great Facebook pages, okay? Thank them. You know, go there. I mean, be a force. Be an advocate for your liberation, for your non-dual realization. You know, start being some of that, you know, male aspect of more direct. It's amazing. Everybody's afraid to say anything on those pages. It's amazing. They all like parrots. Very few comment. I comment, and some people like it, you know, but most are too scared. They won't. That's too male. You know, I gotta be like a female. Go real slow here. I say, hey, wait a minute. You know, thank you, Bhagavan. You know, this has blessed my day. But most people can't do that anymore. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. Just say, hey, Bhagavan. Jai Bhagavan. Jai Bhagavan. J-A-I. Actually, it's pronounced J like hey. I always used to think they're saying, hey, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan. I thought I said, hey, Bhagavan, which is fine to say hey too, because it's like saying hey, you know, like, hey, Bhagavan, hey, truth, I'm hearing you, hey, it's great to say hey. And Jai means victory, Bhagavan, victory, acclaim and victory, Jai Bhagavan, hey, Bhagavan. Hey, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan, Jai Bhagavan. Victory, victory, victory to the truth, victory to the truth, victory to the truth. But there's no reward in that victory at all. No reward at all, no reward at all. And no hope at all, no hope at all, no hope, no reward. This another mantra, no hope, no reward. Another 5-1, no hope, no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. What's the other one? No hope, no reward. No hope, no reward. Instead of no justice, no peace, say no hope, no reward. I mean, I got neither hope nor reward. There's neither hope nor is there reward. There's neither hope nor reward, neither hope nor reward, no hope, no hope, no reward. Thank you. Say thank you, God, no hope, no reward. Wonderful. Those are the greatest blessings I can think of right now, no hope and no reward. This opens the door to abundance for us, opens the door. Man, I got some fancy looking shoes today. It's crazy. This is, can I wear? Of course I could wear them. Not many people are going to wear those shoes. I'll wear them around town. People say, what the heck? What's going on? Is he walking on the moon or something? No, I'm walking on the corpse of hope. I'm without hope and fear or reward. I am completely destitute of hope, fear, and reward. I'm destitute of hope and reward. Thank you very much, God. Thank you very much, Dharma Kings. Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, okay. So we got to it. We got to it. We got to it. And just realize, oh my gosh. It's a game changer. Just wow it, wow it, wow it, wow it, wow it, wow it, wow it. We all think, oh, this will never be said. I can't stand up myself and say this. It's impossible. Forget it. You know, wow, it's too much. This will never be said now. You know, especially now. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Boom, it's happened. Just like that. Boom. Boom, 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 boom. Yeah, absolutely, it's happened. Combined efforts, you know, of the Dharma kings, their top assistants, and Holy Spirit, and you know, so it's a combined effort here. But it's being said, and no backing down. Don't back down from that wave. Yeah, don't back down. Boom, 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 boom. The difference, the guys are out riding these, you know, 30-foot waves. The gals are on the beach saying, "Hey, ocean, could you give me a little less big waves? Could you give me some small, little, pretty waves? Please, pretty please." And they're talking to the ocean, telling them, you know, make the waves smaller. Therefore, you know. So the guys are saying, "Yeah, give me the big waves. I want to ride these big waves." And so it's a different style. Different style. Sometimes you want to ride the big waves. Sometimes you want to ride the little pretty waves, too. Yeah. Pretty waves are nice. That helps too. The big waves are nice too. There's something to be said for these big breakthroughs, right? No hope, no fear. No hope, no fear. No hope, no reward. No hope, no reward. No hope, no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. No hope, no reward. 555. There's the 555s right there for you. We hit the big three triple fives. No hope, no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. No hope, no reward. 555, the triple fives. Remember the triple fives. When you get lost, you're thinking, what about the triple fives? What are triple fives? You have to try to remember triple fives. Triple fives. Okay, five syllables. What are the syllables? There is no hope. Okay, there's one. There is no hope. No. I'm sorry. All hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. All hope is false hope. Then there is no reward. There is no reward. And then no hope, no reward. No hope and no reward. No hope, no reward. The triple fives. The triple fives. Remember the triple fives. We have brought the triple fives to life. Today, and I ran the doubles today. It's like, wow. So I'm eager to do it some more. Yeah, that's pretty cool. And someone told me recently, they said, you know, it's all in the legs. He says, it's all in the legs. You don't have the legs, you don't have anything. It's all in the legs. You really, and I said, wow, you're largely right about that. I mean, it's we don't like to work on the legs so much. There are people ride a stationary bike going to treadmill stuff. No, I mean, I'm hammering the legs in a whole different way. I'm like sidestepping, going backwards, doing all sorts of side work from side to side to side to side to side, hammering for, you know, various, going up hills and stairs and all sorts of things that just hammer the legs. Skipping, 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 skipping. The ankles, oh man, the calves and ankles, oh boy. Most people want to sit in the gym at a nice bench with weights, you know, and pumped iron, you know, 10 sets of, you know, why? Because it shows up in your, I saw some guy recently with his shirt off. I mean, he was just so pumped in his arms and chest. It was unbelievable. But he was all muscle bound. You know, he couldn't function very well. It was ridiculous. He was so ripped. And he spent too much time in the gym. Get out and skip. Start skipping along. Okay? Start skipping along. See how he lasts like that. Do that. How far can you skip? You know, they probably like, you know, they go, but I can, you know, dead, you know, I can pump, you know, bench press, you know, 420 or something. So, I mean, how often do you need to bench press 420? I mean, is it like a car on you, you know, the car roll over, you need to push the car off of you or something? I mean, when do we actually use, you know, the Billy to bench press 420. You lie on your back and you go like this. And, I mean, what do we use that for? It's all for show. It's all for show. But our legs, we use our legs constantly. Jumping out of the way of something, you know, hopping this way, moving this way. I was in the market today, and this lady came screaming out of an aisle. I was going along the main area of the market, and she was on a side aisle. And she just came out of that side aisle like she just expected nobody to be there without even looking. I mean, you know, who does that? And I just had to immediately break. And I went up on my toes like this, but very gracefully with a smile. And she goes, "Oh, sorry." She was hoping nobody would be there. You know, this is the aggression that we get in the Silicon Valley, is the way people drive it now is the way they go drive in the supermarket. They're like overly aggressive there too. And, you know, I could easily plowed into her. I should have, but I was able to stop on a dime, just easily, effortlessly just stop. I was amazed, like, wow, do I have a good brakes there, quick brakes. So there's an advantage right there. And these little electric cars now, wow. Do they just take advantage of everybody? They just go flying up past a long line of cars in like a lane that's gonna turn left. They get up there and then they just jam their way into the line. You know, boom, because they're small and they're so quick. Electric cars are very quick. Like, they'll smoke a Porsche. You know, even these little Chevy Sparks or something, they'll smoke a Porsche off the line. Because the Porsche's got too many governors. You need RPM and engine stuff. Electrical, you don't need any RPMs. It's direct power, straight power to the drive, the differential drive shaft. Just differential for them, really. Straight to the axles, really. Straight to the wheels. And so they're just like so rude. It's unbelievable how rude they are, how arrogant they are. Wow, I saw some more stuff today. It's just, you just want to scream at them. You just want to get a hold of them. You know, and just say something to them. I mean, it's so arrogant the way they operate. Just like the rest of you in line, you don't matter, because I got an electric car and I matter. You're all ruining the planet and I'm saving the planet. So guess what? I'm gonna just jam my way ahead of all of you. And people take it here. You know, they're a bunch of lemmings here. Man, in the old days, that would never settle. Now you do something like that, and some muscle car guys would chase you down. They really would. And, they'd let the air out of your tires or something. I mean, they'd do something. And that's okay, you know. Nobody would say that's wrong or anything like that. You know, they'd say, well, hey, great, thanks for taking care of that, you know. Or, you know, they'd figure out, guys are pretty inventive like that. They'd figure out something to do. I don't know what. That wouldn't, do anything too bad, but they'd just let you know, hey, that's very unacceptable what you just did. They'd fall into a gas station or something, they couldn't gas, they'd come out and like let the air out of their tires or I don't know. They could figure something out. Put sugar in their gas tank, that's a little drastic. Sometimes they go overboard. Okay, we understand that. There's some stuff that's not so good. But nobody lifts a finger right now. Nobody lifts a finger. Nothing. They're all just saying, "Yeah, we're terrible. We're terrible. We deserve to be abused like that. That way, yeah." It's just self-loathing, self-hating liberals here. It's amazing. You can't believe the stuff that happens here, and nobody says a word. And I just want to say, hey, you can't have a culture like this. Say something. Somebody say something. But if you do say something, you'll get thrown in jail. It's like backwards here. The law is backwards. It's like it favors criminals here, actually. So if you do anything to set the criminal straight, meaning set the culture straight, they'll throw you in jail, throw away the key. They don't want this culture to be set straight. They want it to be completely upside down and backwards. So it keeps generating hope, and so they don't get the reward. Now, I don't want a reward. I don't want to see through this whole dream. Oh, no, that's too much for me, And then, okay, the great news is, guess what? There is no reward. And I don't need to keep generating hope either, right? Hope, because there's no such thing as hope in reality. So I don't need to keep trying to change reality by trying to generate hope, which means I have to go live in a threat-based dream. I have to dream a threat-based dream. Have to. Dream of hope is a threat-based dream, intrinsically, isn't it? Yes, it is. Oh, yes, it is. Have we finished this? We finished off the Kavita. It's amazing how people keep trying to trap you. You say you're doing something good, and they, hey, I thought you said this. You know, like you're not being consistent with what you're saying because they're so fearful. Yeah, you know, that's a very brittle, brittle attitude without understanding that this is an art form. It's not a. It's the science of art, so to speak. It's the artful science of the spiritual path. Following where the evidence leads us, but also having to manage our success and the continuity fear at the same time. That people think they're trying to, they think you're trying to trick them. So there's no faith. There's no faith. Everyone's so brittle, they have no faith. I said, look, I'm a spiritual advisor, and you have to recognize that I'm advising those who are like absolutely terrified. So of course I have to tortoise inherit. I say these are the habits I have. I'm not saying if you backslide at all, oh, you're gonna, you know, there are no reward. Well, there is no reward anyway. So relax. You know, focus on that. There's no reward. Isn't that like the greatest thing we've ever heard? There's no reward? And isn't that the most counterintuitive thing that the world would say? That's completely counterintuitive. Everybody here is fighting for some reward, but we're fighting to realize there is no reward. And that's the great good news, actually. That's the gospel, the good news. There is no reward. So I hope that guy was all right. They're trying to run five doubles. Oh my God. Maybe the Holy Spirit's telling me, you got to run five doubles before you're done with all this. Okay, I said, okay, I'll do it eventually. I don't know when, but maybe I can run five doubles. You can run five doubles. That's pretty strong, to say the least. But it's out there. You know, next step for me is to run two doubles. Five, I don't know. Maybe in my dreams, but you know, it's feasible, it's possible. I think you'd be pretty tired after that. Maybe it's too much. Maybe you run four, but we have the three fives. Maybe three fives is enough. Three doubles. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. No hope, no reward. The three fives. See the three fives. We have the three fives. I'll try to call this video the three fives. The ultimate spiritual practice, the three fives. There is no reward. All hope is false hope. No hope, no reward. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. No hope, no reward. Wow. Just burn that into your mind. Burn that into your consciousness, your awareness, your... Evaporate the continuity fear. Massive evaporators. We need to evaporate quickly. We are doing it quickly. Like I said, I need to get those doubles before July 24th. Well, guess what? What's today? June 28th, I think? Or maybe it's the 29th, maybe. I'm not sure what day it is. It's the 28th. Okay, 28th. We'll watch this on the 29th. So I'm like almost a month early on running the doubles, you know? This is great. I was actually ready before July, which in the back of my mind, I have to be ready before July. That's what I'm thinking. So I've got to be proclaiming the truth, you know, in July. And so I've already did it. I'm proclaiming the truth here. The three fives is really the heart of the truth. It's the heart of the non-dual message, actually. And I know many people are thinking like, we'll never get there because nobody's saying this. But now this being said, you can realize, oh yes, we can get there. Oh yes, we can. I didn't realize you could say that all hope is false hope. All hope is death. All hope is false hope. That hope equals death. I didn't realize that anyone could say that. Is that possible? We can't say that here. It's taboo. No, it's being said. It's not taboo. Taboo's been broken here. The hold of the taboo has been absolutely broken. No more taboo. So hallelujah to that. Now I'm going to end this pretty soon here. Have to do some errands and work for, you know, get some stuff, get dinner and all this stuff for people. And, then go to Facebook or something and dig on all the pictures and quotes of Ram Maharshi, Sri Srinad Maima, Sagardar Maharaj, those pop up, the hammer, called the hammer of the Sagardar Maharaj, something like that. I got to put a link up to that. It's a different style. He's very direct, very male, his approach, super direct, super male, almost too strong that way, you see. But that's nice to get that flavor. It's really great. I mean, it's like what? It's like Trump. You're like, what? I haven't paid attention to Trump since August or something or whatever. I stopped watching the news. So I don't have, you know, I don't follow him at all. But I just know he's very direct, very blunt. He's very male. And people, I guess maleness freaks people out. Are you going to get us in a war? No. It's weakness that gets us in a war. It's all the appeasers and overly feminine culture that gets you in wars, because the other people say, hey, look, they're so weak, they can't even defend themselves. They're here in the Silicon Valley, nobody can defend themselves. Say, hey, don't cut in front of me. They just take it like lemmings. It's unbelievable. Nobody says anything. I feel like I'm the only person in the Silicon Valley, in the Bay Area, that will even speak up about anything. And so that makes it difficult to speak up. But if you get everybody speaking up, it's easy. It's easy. So the 3-5s. And again, don't worry if you don't want to speak up on it, yeah, right? Because that's really, you see stuff like that to your family members, you know, they're going to like think you're absolutely insane. And you say, no, I'm doing non-dual. They say, well, non-dual's terrible then. You know, you got to stop it. You know, it's driving you crazy. You make it turn you into an idiot. No. Reason, actually, we're trying to sabotage reality here, and we think that's normal, so we keep sabotaging our reason. But actually, we'll see, if you look at reason will show you that no reward is exactly wonderful, and any reward we could get would be too much for us, so it's freaking us out, this whole falsity we've imagined. But people don't use their reason, so they just say, well, I don't really see your reasoning. That's because they refuse to, they're sabotaging their own reason. People spend their whole lives just sabotaging their reason. They've been obsessed with it. Almost everyone here. Very few actually allow reason to speak to them and speak for them. Ram Maharshi speaks for us. He speaks from the standpoint of reason. He speaks for us. He stands up for us. So say, thank you, Bhagavan, for standing up for us. Thank you, Bhagavan, for standing up for us. We greatly appreciate it. You know, as the Dharma kings realize there's no death. Death is just the flip side of hope, trying to generate hope. The only reason there's death is we're trying to generate hope. There's no need to generate hope at all. There's no hope in reality. So death doesn't touch them because they don't ask for it. And they don't need a body to generate hope. So they're totally alive, completely alive. And they're able to, they hear us. When we thank them, they hear us very loud and clear. Say, thank you, Bhagavan, for standing up for us, and mean it, you know, from the heart. It resonates throughout your being. Ram Maharshi hears that loud and clear. I said, love to you, Longchenpa, and I saw his picture, and I suddenly saw his weeping. You know, he heard it loud and clear. It means love to truth, love to reality, love to liberation, love to compassion, love to bodhisattva-ness, and love to, you know, love to you, Longchenpa, for standing up for us. Standing up for us. So thank them for standing up for us. And they absolutely hear it. They absolutely hear it. They hear it clearer than we do, because there's no obstacle to hearing. There's no body obstacle. Why? What did you say? There's no obstacle. They don't interpose an obstacle between in communication at all. They don't need any obstacle for communication. There's no reward. They know in reality is all just perfect, right? And there's no hope. They don't need hope and fear and threat. We don't need, I hope this communication works. What is that? That's saying that there's the threat that it won't work. So they hear us loud and clear. Sometimes we wonder, right? Yeah, sometimes I say, wow, you know, I've got this issue, got this problem, got these bills to pay, got this and this, you know. Are you hearing? Are you hearing? But you know they are hearing. They do hear us loud and clear. So we just got to keep pushing it forward here. The culture is going to fall and fall hard. This culture is so freaking brittle. It's overly feminized to an extreme extent. Just like if you over masculinize a culture, it gets very brittle too, right? Yeah. So we've got the other extreme. It's way over feminized now. That's why maybe I want to drive a muscle car around. Yeah, right. I think the next car is going to be a muscle car. Say, hey, you know, let's bring back a little muscle here in terms of speaking up. You know, it's got a little sound to it, little power. Let's hear those lake pipes roar. Pedal to the floor, hear the lake pipes. Well, hear the dual quads drink. You know, in other words, the dual carburetors. No, it's four barrel carburetors, four chamber carburetors. In other words, each chamber, piston chamber, is getting its own carburation. So dual quads means four barrel carbs or something. Hear them drink. I mean, hear them sucking in the air and the gas. It's opening up. The arteries are opening up and it's just sucking in. Yeah, that's fuel. Pedal to the floor, hear those dual quads drink. Now the 413's lead is starting to shrink. He's got ram induction, but it's understood. I got a fuel-injected engine sitting under my hood. Right. It's a muscle car, muscle car, muscle car. And people say, you thinking of getting a muscle car? Really? I said, ah, no, I don't. But really, in the back of my mind, I'm saying, yeah, like a Ferrari. I actually was just sleeping and dozing and had my eyes closed, and suddenly I saw, like, I was sitting by a window. I looked out through the window and there was this cherry red Ferrari, sort of a dark red cherry red Ferrari, so to speak. It's like, oh my gosh, a Ferrari right outside my window. Time to get a muscle car. Let's bring a little bit of directness back into it all. And non-dualist, you cannot afford to be so brittle right now. You cannot be brittle. The key is sit quietly and wow it. And you lose your brittleness when you do that. Immediately the ego says, you're so brittle, you're so brittle, you're going to break, you're going to break. Say, no, this is not going to break me. I'm not going to break. This is going to be great. When reason steps in, it's going to show me how wonderful it is. I'm not going to get all brittle and break. Yeah, but my family said, well, that's their issue. My issue here is liberation from hope, which is liberation from death. So I'm not going to break. I'm going to hear this. I'm not going to break. It's like that. Well, I could go on forever here, but, you know, it's just, wow, don't want to stop, but at some point, got to stop. It's like, you know, muscle car, you just want to keep driving. They're putting out some good ones these days. Camaro and the Challenger, a couple of them. Let's see what else they can put out. I don't know. I've never had a muscle car like that. But I think I would drive one now, as a matter of fact. Maybe that's why I'm getting in shape. You know, when you jump out of a muscle car, you can't be some blob. You can't be a slug. You can't, like, be a slug that, like, slimes its way out of a muscle car. You know, you got a 750 sitting under the hood. You got to hop out of your car, you know, flip your sunglasses up and just, like, move, you know, like, wow, I'm just moving smooth. I got power here, too. I'm quick here, too. Now, you know, as a fat slug techie, you know, oozes out of the driver's seat, you know, sort of like a slide. It's kind of, you know, get the, what's my smartphone telling me? Okay. That just doesn't work. You know, it just doesn't work. So, you know, coming out in a t-shirt and jeans and tennis shoes, you just pop out of there, just... I'm ready to go, man. I'm ready to split town. I'm ready to get out of town in a hurry. Yeah, I'm ready to do 150 out of town. And I can do it also. I'll do it. Got the 3-5s, man. I'm gonna put 555 on the car. 555. The 3-5s. All hope is false hope. There is no reward. No hope, no reward. The 3-5s. 555. Put that decal. 555 decal. Very cool. All right, very great. That's a good place to hit it. That's it. 555, 555, 555.